are in Parashat Toldot. We are going to read from the Zera Shimshon, Siman Gimel. And we're in Parashat Toldot, where I've mentioned throughout the week a parasha full of action that you can sell the script to Hollywood, make some fancy movies just on this parasha. And of course, one of the main themes of the parasha is how Yaakov steals the blessing. We spoke about it yesterday, about the birth of Esav and Yaakov, and many other things. But there's a lot of questions when it comes to the time of the pregnancy of Rivka. I mean, we started the parasha that she couldn't get pregnant. We spoke about it in the last few classes in the Zohar, why she couldn't, what happened when Yaakov and Yitzchak intervened, and so forth. And we already explained that she couldn't get pregnant for 20 years. And in that 20 years, she was praying for children. One of the explanations why she didn't get pregnant is because all the barren women in the generation got pregnant. So Hashem says, listen, I'm going to give her a child. She's going to stop praying. But we explained many other things. But Rivka was praying to get children. Only when Yitzchak intervened, then we explained yesterday in the Zohar that Yitzchak prayed on her behalf, not for himself. He knew he was going to have kids. He was just afraid that maybe she's going to end up being barren and he's going to have kids with some other wife, like Avram had to go to Agar. So that's why he was like, okay, that I don't want. I want to have it with Rivka. The second that he prayed on her behalf, then they got the kids. And we explained the whole power point of the prayer. But then, of course, during the pregnancy, then Rivka has a terrible time. And there is a verse, I spoke about it yesterday, we explained it a little bit in the Zohar. Today we're going to see the approach of the Zera Shimshon, which I believe is one of the most powerful messages we have that has to do with our current times. Besides that, we see a clear prophecy that Hashem gave Rivka at the time, for not necessarily that she's going to have two kids, prophecy for the end of days. And it's really tied real amazingly with what's going on right now in the world. So without further ado, let's go to the verse, which you can find it in our parasha, of course. Vayitrotzetzu habanim bekirba. This can be found in our parasha, chapter 25, verse 22. And it says, I'm going to give you the translation, even though the translation doesn't make sense. The translation says that the boys, the two twins, struggled within her. Very lame translation. I told you yesterday, Vayitrotzetzu means in Hebrew that they, litrotzetz is to run backwards and forth. That's first of all. The Zohar explains that it comes from the word lerotzetz, to smash, like when you, it says when you see a snake, you have to smash the head, lerotzetz et rosho. So the Zohar says, litrotzetzu, one tried to smash the other. Here it says struggle. Really what happens, there was already a fight within the womb. The two babies are fighting with each other in the room. Now, Rivka says, if the struggle of pregnancy is so great, and later on, of course, she finds out that the struggle is great or huge because one of them is going to be wicked. So what does Rivka says? Im ken, lama ze anochi? If this is the case that a rasha is going to come out of me, why did I even bother to pray? Why did I pray so much? Better to be barren. Well, I'm going to bring now a wicked individual into the world, an Esav, that up until today we're suffering from him. And she says, why is it coming through me? I shouldn't have prayed. Rashi says, Im ken gadol tzar ibu, lama ze anochi mitava mitpalelet? If the pregnancy is so hard, and not only that, later on will come such a rasha, why am I bothering? Why am I praying? Okay. Now comes the Zera Shimshon and presents a few questions. First of all, מה המקום לשאלה זו לזעוק ולהתחרט על מה שעבר? What is the point to regret what she prayed already and what she already did in the past? Because if Rivka comes and says, למה זה אנוכי? Why did I bother? What are you regretting or what you did? I'm not talking about when there's a sin, of course you need to regret. But when you pray for something, then you regret you asked it? That doesn't make sense. That's first of all. And more than that, he adds, what? A person will pray for something. It's like almost means like saying, a person will pray, I want to meet my wife, prays for 3 years, finally gets the wife, half a year later, the marriage is not that great. Ah, you know, I shouldn't have prayed for you. I mean, and some wise men will probably tell that to their wife and be like, well, excuse me? So, and you can imagine, a woman can get pregnant, she finally has a child, the child messes something up in the house, and she tells him, you know, I shouldn't have prayed for you. I mean, we don't understand the approach here. Why? Okay, next, another question. Rivka didn't know what's going on, so she took a trip to Tzfat. She came to Shem and Ever, right? She went to Lidrosh, she went to the Tzaddik, to the Navi, to the Prophet. She went to ask Shem, what's going on? What's going to be here? And it says as follows. V'chi isha meuberet shesovelet tzarot holechet zel Navi v'chacham. A person has sorrow in her pregnancy, she goes to a prophet. Go take a rest, put your legs up high, I don't know what, drink a cup of water. You're going to the prophet because you have a little bit of trouble with your pregnancies? Okay, next question. Ve'od ma'wa terutz l'shne goyim. Now what happens is, Rivka comes to Shem and Ever, right across the street, and Shem tells her, you know, two nations are going to come out of your womb. It's not saying nations, it says shnei goyim. Goy, I know a lot of people don't like the word goy. Goy is not a derogatory word. A lot of non-Jews think that goy is a disgusting word, like a curse. When I lived in America, and a non-Jew would be like, oh, why are you cursing me? I didn't curse you. Goy means a body, by the way. Also, we are called a goy. We are separated goy. Goy kadosh. We're also a goy. Goy means in Hebrew, by the way, a body. But nevertheless, it says shnei goyim. Okay. Rashi says something very interesting, if you read Rashi on the parasha. Rashi says, these two goyim, it's not Esav and Yaakov. It's Antoninos and Rebbe. Now, Antoninos and Rebbe, there's a whole, I don't want to say a love story, because not people to get some weird ideas. But Rebbe and Antoninos had like a really very, very, very special relationship. So Rashi says, no, it's not referring to Yaakov and Esav. Oh, it's talking about these two great nations. Rebbe was the Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, the leader of the generation at the time, who later on wrote the Mishnah and more. And Antoninus was the Caesar, the Roman Caesar. And they were very good friends. There's actually a story that exactly when Rebbe was born, they made a decree to vaccinate everybody. No, that's in our generation. They made a decree to nobody can circumcise themselves. Okay? So, like today, we have all these weird decrees. Go with a mask, lock yourself down in your house, get a shot of something that you don't even know what's inside. So, nothing's new under the sun. So, the town also, they had a decree that posters all over the town. Nobody's allowed to do a Brit Milah. Now, what happens is that they called the mother and father of Rebbe to the palace, to whatever, wanted to see. So, they switched the babies. Instead of taking Rebbe, they took Antoninos. And the mother of Rebbe was breastfeeding him and all. They looked, okay, he's not circumcised. And then they flipped him. Later on, when they took Rebbe, when he was older, they said, oh, look, he's circumcised. Later on, there's a story says that they came back and says, look, they actually, one of the people there said, no, they actually circumcised this, but their God did a miracle and the circumcision reversed. And it was a miracle. But anyway, there's a lot of stories with Rebbe and Antoninos. And so Rashi says the two goyim, the two nations, that's referring to Antoninos and Rebbe. So he says, Lama lo pirshu al Yaakov ve'Esav? Why is Rashi coming and telling me, oh no, Shem was not talking about Yaakov and Esav, talking about generations forward, about two other individuals. Why? And why dafka Rebbe and Antoninos? Shehayu harashim ve'avot shel shtei umot. But at the end of the day, both Yaakov and Esav were the heads of these two nations, the nation of Israel and the nation of Esav, Edom. This is already third question. Ve'od perash Rashi. Now Rashi says another thing. Mime'aych yiparedu. And again, the translations are very, very horrible because it says, the translation says, we'll separate from your inwards. Me'aym is not inwards. Me'aym is intestines. But nevertheless, this is another way when it says about a pregnant woman, me'aim, it means in your stomach. But it says the text that they're both going to split from each other. Min ha-me'ayim, hem nifradim, they're going out of the belly, the womb, or the intestines, right? Zeh le-rishon, zeh le-tumo. One goes to a path of being wicked, another one goes to the path of being righteous. Okay, and this is again Rashi saying that. Ve-pirush zeh shayach shel Yaakov ve-Esav, ve-lo al shnei leumim. So if this is the case, if you're telling me that these two nations are going to separate from your womb, didn't you just tell me a second ago that it's talking about Antoninus and Rebbe? So, but yeah, but now you're telling me that they were going to come out of your womb. So you what? You're contradicting yourself. Okay, now that we have a few questions here, now let's see what the text says. You understand the questions? You follow, you remember? Okay. Ve'yesh la'vin. Now we can understand the concept. Lefi shechava b'chet'a garma shiplu nitzotzot shel kedusha toch ha'klipa. It all starts on a beautiful sunny day when Chava, Erev Shabbat, instead of going to the supermarket and buying food for Shabbat, she sins. Unfortunately, listen, we're all sin. No judging her. I'm probably 10 times worse than her. But nevertheless, she sinned, a severe sin. And because of her sin, she caused sparks of Kedusha, of holiness, to fall into the Klipa. Right? Klipa is a husk. Klipa is a negative energy. What opposes Kedusha and holiness. She sinned. The sparks of holiness fell down into the klipa, and it says as follows: Ze gorem leshlitata tum'a ba'olam. Because of that, it caused the impurity to control the world. So right now, the majority of rulership in the world is impure, coming from other side of holiness, tum'a, and all because one sin. U'mize ba'im ha'resha'im, and because of this action, all the wicked people come out. Gormim tsar kaful aisha, and they're causing a double sorrow to the woman. Vakadosh bochu amar lechava. Where do we know that it's causing a double sorrow? Because Hashem told Sarah, you remember, I mean, this Chava, which is actually Sarah, who came later to do a tikkun for her, if you remember, we learned that already in Parashat Vayera, when the angels came, Kaet Sarah velechaya ben, when they told her, so that's when she did a tikkun. Why Kaet Chaya? Velesarah ben Chaya was her name. Then when she sinned, it changed to Chava. Changed to Chava for a few reasons. The Yud of Chaya was pulled into the Klipa, became a Vav, so it was Chava. And not only that, the Nachash, the snake, the serpent, a serpent in our snake in Aramaic is Chivya. So he came to her and told her, my name is Chivya. Your name should be now Chava because Adam divorced her. But nevertheless, later on, Sarah did a tikkun. That's why the Malachim said, "Ken kaet Chaya velesarah ben." Sarah did the tikkun for Chaya, Chava, and now she has a child. But nevertheless, Hashem told Chava, "Harba arbe etzbonech veheryonech." This can be found in the book of Bereshit, chapter 3, verse 16. If you remember, with the sin of Adam, Chava, and the snake, Adam got 10 curses. Chava got 10 curses. The snake got 10 curses. The land got 9 curses. Totaling at 39 curses that were given because of the sin. Therefore, we have Shabbat to observe, and corresponding to that, we have 39 labors that we're not allowed to do. It's not only because in the Mishkan, in the tabernacle, they weren't able to build the Mishkan on Shabbat. Rather, observing Shabbat is a rectification for the 39 curses of Adam, Chava, the snake, and the land. But one of the curses, or punishments, or what Chava got, harba arbe teryonech. Now, again, translations to learn Torah in English doesn't work. Right? Because the translation for this verse is, I will increase your sorrow. In Hebrew it says, harba arbe. Why saying the same word twice? With different pronunciation. Harba, harbe, that's not going to increase. Why hakefel? Why doubling? Harba, harbe, milvad, mashe darshu chazal. Okay, so our sages in Tractate Eruvin, they explain that haynu lomar she milvad tzar harayon, od yetzar kaful she tolid reshaim. What does our sages explain? And you can find that more in length. Go to page 100b in Tractate Eruvin, where it explains it more in depth. But it says, why it says twice harba arbe? First you're going to have sorrow, the actual pregnancy, and then another sorrow that you give birth to a rasha, to a wicked person. I can tell you as a parent, one of the worst things you can see is that your child goes to the wrong path. So much more so if he's a great wicked individual. And this can also be found, I'm just giving you some references that you can go and learn by yourself. Tractate Yoma, page 82b also. So if this is the case, that's why Rivka says, why do I need to bother with all this? Now I'm going to have sorrow in the pregnancy, and then sorrow to see that a wicked person came out of me? Okay. But the Talmud, in Tractate Sota, page 12b, it says as follows. Nashim tzadkaniot lo hayu bepitka shel Chava. Oh. So any righteous woman was not included in the curse of Chava. So a woman who's not righteous is included in the curse of Chava, that she'll have sorrow in labor, in pregnancy, and also sorrow if chas v'shalom, the child goes on the wrong path. But the Talmud in Tractate says, no. That applies to women who are not righteous. Righteous woman, it doesn't affect them. And if this is the case, bevadai shelo telad nakim tzadikim. So if this is the case, then she can only give birth to a tzadik. You understand now? If a woman who's right, only righteous women are not included in the curse, so by default, she can only give a birth to a tzadik. Right? If you don't following, tell me, I'll skip and you'll continue not to follow. But no, it's important that you get the sophistication. The Zera Shimshon is very sophisticated how he thinks. And all to kind of go like this and then to do a tada. Okay, so I'll just say it again. The Talmud says that the curse from Sarah affected all women. Why harba arbe? Why twice? Sorrow for pregnancy, sorrow if the child becomes wicked. End of story. Now the Talmud comes and says, yeah, but that only affects wicked women. And the tzadikot, righteous woman, doesn't affect. So if this is the case, so if a woman is righteous, there's no option that she will give birth to a rasha, right? To a wicked individual. End of story. Shariyen lehem lisvol afilu atzar ragil. And if this is the case, so they shouldn't even have any sorrow. Not only that they cannot have a wicked person, they couldn't have any sorrow because they're not included in the curse of Sarah. That's now putting us in type of a niche. And that puts more Rivka saying, wait a minute, I'm not a tzedeket? Rivka, I mean, she was. And she had Ruach HaKodesh and she knew the Talmud inside out before it was written. Now Rivka is like, wait a minute, if I'm a tzedeket, then I shouldn't have not sorrow in pregnancy and not to have a wicked child. And if now the prophet is telling, first of all, I do have sorrow in pregnancy, and the prophet is telling me I'm going to have a wicked child, must be that I'm not a tzedeket. What's going on here? Makes her very, very upset. Im ken Rivka hayta yodat be'atzma shi tzedeket. But Rivka says, listen, I might be a nice, humble woman, but I know I'm a tzedeket. She knows who she was. לפיכך התפללה לרעיון שהייתה בטוחה בצדקתה. Therefore, she said, okay, I'm a tzedeket, I'm going to pray to get pregnant. Because if she's thinking, if I'm going to give birth to a wicked individual, I'm not going to bother. I'll just die without kids. What's the big deal? Let Yitzchak go find him another wife. Let him build the house of Israel through another wife. I'm not going to take responsibility. You know how many stories we have in our past that somebody was about to do something bad and said, I don't want to take responsibility for this. Somebody not too long ago came and asked me something and I said, listen, I don't want to be involved in something like that. Why should a sin or something bad come out from an action that I'm somehow connected to? I don't want to have my hands dirty on anything. So it says, Rivka was convinced that she's a tzedeket. Therefore, let me pray to have a child. I'm not going to have a wicked child. If she would think for 1 second that she's going to bring out a wicked individual like Esav to the world, she would say, thank you so much, I don't need children. The Midrash says, on this verse, I'd rather have sorrow in this world, but not to cause a greater damage in this world, and it will affect the entire world and in the world to come. So we know two individuals that said that. Both Avraham Avinu and David HaMelech. David HaMelech says, כן אמר דוד, אם עתיד אני להוליד בנים ולהכיסך, מוטב לי. If I'm going to bring kids, and I'm, these kids are going to become now wild or wicked, and I'm going to make you Hashem angry, I don't need kids. So we have two great men, David HaMelech and Avraham Avinu, said the same thing. Avraham said the same thing. Ani lecharei, I'll die without kids. Just don't bring a wicked individual because of me. Now, that's putting Rivka in a big problem. ולכן כששמעה שנתרוצצו הבנים בקרבה, when Rivka heard, wait a minute, I have a tzaddik and I have a wicked one. שהיה לה צער גדול מהעיבור שלה, because she saw she has sorrow in the pregnancy, and now she's getting the next sign, a wicked person. הייתה מסתפקת ותוהה בעצמה, איך אפשר זה? She says, how could I do such a thing? She wasn't questioning herself now. Oh, I thought I'm a tzaddiket. Oh, how they say, bummer. I thought I'm a tzaddiket. That's, she didn't care about that. She was like, if I knew that, I wouldn't bother to pray. So that's answering our first question. Why would Rivka regret praying? So she says, because now I didn't know. If I would know, I wouldn't do that. Shari achat mishtaim lo imana. If she only had one of the signs, sorrow and pregnancy, or wicked, okay. But both? Then she says, okay, this is a big problem for me. Oh, haklal shanashim tzidkaniyot lo ayu bepitka shelcha v'eino emet. Now, there's a question. Rivka has sorrow when she's pregnant, and she knows now she's going to give birth to a wicked individual. So now she's regretting for praying. Now it puts us in another big question. There's two options. Either the Talmud was wrong by saying that the women were cursed because of Chava and the curse really doesn't exist, right? What are the first option? Haklal she'anashim tzadkaniyot lo hayu bapitka shel Chava eno emet. Right? So what's the first option? That women who are righteous, sorry, I didn't explain it well, that women who are righteous are not excluded from the curse of Chava. That's option number one, because Rivka was a tzaddiket, and she got sorrow and a wicked person. So maybe the option that righteous women are excluded, maybe it's not true, and they are included. Option number one. Umishumachi nitkayem ba'arbe arbe tzeret bonech. And if it's option number one, that it's a lie, therefore, Rivka had sorrow when she's pregnant, sorrow for with a rasha, harba harba et esbonech, right? Because she has a ubar, an embryo, a baby that is going to be wicked. Or what's other option? Shehaklal acher shel yada inish benafshei itzadik o irasha hu eno emet. The other option is that the prophecy is that one is a tzadik, one is a rasha. That's not true. I mean, after all, she didn't see the kids yet. She could have said to Shem, maybe you're a false prophet, maybe you don't know what you're talking about. So which one is the truth? She didn't know, there's no ultrasound. The prophet tells her, I see one a tzaddik, one a wicked person. So maybe that's not the truth. Okay, now let's explain it. ולפי שמתחילה האישה מתפללת על ההיריון, ולאחר שנתעברה מתפללת על הלידה, normally, any woman, and especially in this case, first she prays to get pregnant. Then you pray that the child will be a Zera Kayama, a good, healthy child, and God-fearing, and so forth. Mishum hachi yalcha lemidrasho shel Shem, sheyagid lahim ra'uyu shetachzor ba mima shekvar itpalela stam. Rivka went to Shem to tell him, listen, sorrow in my birth, in my pregnancy, I have. Tell me if there's a wicked individual in there, so I can try maybe to pray. Maybe, I don't know, maybe something will happen. She wanted to know. Ulehatnot kmo she'asu Avraham v'David. And if this is the case, then she can give a condition, like with Avram and David, by saying, Hashem, listen, I know a wicked one is coming. Maybe kill them inside. I don't know. Kill me. I don't know. But to make a condition. שאם יהיו בנים מכריסים, לא יהיו בנים קיימה. Like Rashi explains with Avraham and David, that they made a condition with the Kadosh Baruch Hu, if you're giving me a Rasha, I don't need to. אם כן, גדול צער העיבור, if this is the case, that the pregnancy, there's a lot of sorrow there, שאיני ראויה לסבול צער גדול של עיבור, and I'm supposed to have this sorrow, או מפני שאין אני צדקת. Rivka wanted to know, I wanted to know if I have to suffer from the pregnancy, or maybe I'm not even a tzaddiket. Maybe I'm living some delusional, maybe I'm delusional. Maybe I'm not tzaddiket. Tzaddiket means a righteous woman. Or mishum she'af ha'tzigniyot ayu b'pitka shel chava. Or maybe, like I said, option number one, that the righteous women are not included in the curse of chava. Well, tell me what's going on. Im ken, טעיתי להתפלל על ההיריון. I want to know if I made a mistake that I prayed for this pregnancy. Okay? Why? So I can do תשובה. שהרי אברהם ודוד פירשו דבריהם שאם עתידים הם לא להיות ברשעים, לא היו רוצים בנים. אברהם and David says, if I'm going to give birth to a wicked person, I don't need kids. Same thing with Rivka. והייתה מצטערת ומתפחדת שטעתה בתפילתה. So Rivka wanted to know if she made a mistake. She had sorrow just from thinking of maybe making a mistake. Sometimes you pray for something, and you know, I think there's a saying in English, they say, be careful what you wish for, right? So you have to sometimes be careful what you wish for. Okay. Now she's all upset. She goes to the prophet. So the Kadosh Baruch Hu sends her a message through the prophet. Shnei goyim bevitnech. There are two goyim, two bodies, two babies in your stomach. It wasn't ultrasound. There wasn't a device to hear the heart rate. So she got a prophecy. You have two bodies in your stomach. Our sages explain. Shnei rashei goyim. There are going to be two heads of great nations. What did our sages explain? Antoninus and Rabbi. One is because a president, a king, is the head of the entire nation. You don't have to be Yaakov or Yitzchak or Avram. If you are now just Lehavdil Elef Avdalot, not to compare, but you have a president in our generation, he's the head of the country. Whether they like him or not, it's irrelevant. But he's the head of the nation. So our sages said, yeah, it's referring to Antoninus, who was the head of the Roman Empire, and Rabbi, who was the head of the Jewish nation. Klomar shesibat tzara ena michamat ha'erayon, which means that the sorrow that she has nothing to do with the pregnancy. Shevaday hu shehatzadkaniyot lo ayu bepitka shel chava, because the righteous women are not included in the curse of chava. So we now shoo away option number one. Righteous women are not included in the curse of Chava. So where does the sorrow coming? The sorrow is not coming from that. The sorrow is coming from something else. Right? Klomar sibat tzara eno michamat ha'irayon. The sorrow is not coming from the pregnancy. Vegam ha'emetu shehi tzadeket murah. And now we know what that means. Now we're disqualifying the other option, that there's no doubt if Rivka is righteous or not. She's 100%. Tzadeket gemura. Tzadik gemur. A righteous, complete righteous woman. Ve'lo haya min haroi she'tolid ben rasha. Now comes another thing. If she's tzadeket, how does she have a wicked son? Ve'ze ha'tzar hu adrama michamat zechuta. So now we're kind of putting things in order. A, righteous women are not included in the curse of Sarah. B, Rivka was a complete tzaddiket. Comes now question number three. If she's a complete tzaddiket and the righteous women are not included in the curse of Sarah, so how does she have a wicked child? And of course, also sorrow. Michamat sechuta, because of her merit. She'ata ha'klipa v'akdusha merivot zo in zo. The klipa and the kdusha are fighting with each other. Kedusha means holiness, is represented by Yaakov. The klipa, the impurity, the tum'ah, is represented by Esav. And they're fighting head to head. Shakdusha rotza lotzi et shela mitoch haklipa. Why is the kedusha, the holiness, is fighting with the klipa? Because what belongs to the kedusha is captured in the klipa. Give me what I have, it's mine. The kedusha says, I'm not going to give it up. And I'm saying that now as a side note, we'll conclude it in the end. But when I do a sin, my godly sparks go to the klipah, go to the other side of kedusha. And so much more so when it comes to the purity of my soul and my body, which one of the most severe sins in all generations is kedushat habrit, guarding the brit. And when I give from my chayut, from my energy, from my life force, my seed, my semen, to the wrong place, it goes to the klipah. So part of me is held by the klipah. So the kedusha says, give it back. It has to be a fight here. So why is the fight? Let me read it again. She'ata ha-klipa v'kedusha merivot. Now the klipa and the kedusha are fighting. Why? She'akedusha rotza lehotzi et shela. The kedusha says, I need to take out what belongs to me. So you think the klipa is not going to put up a fight? Of course it's going to do. U'misham yatza Antoninos. And therefore Antoninos came out. Antoninos came out from klipa. I mean, apparently, it was good. He was, I don't want to now say he was like kind of a Trump that helped the Jews. Ooh, now I'm going to get a lot of headache from that. But but Antoninus helped the nation of the Jews. He had a good connection with Rabbi. Nevertheless, he says, Antoninus came out of the klipa, shehu hapri hanifrad ma'apsolet. He was the fruit that came out of the dirt, the klipa, the husk, the peel. ואף על פי שאנטונינוס היה מלך וראש, even though he was a king and a head, הראש והמלך שקולים וקולים כולם. The head or the king is corresponding to an entire nation. מכל מקום אי אפשר להקליפה לפלוט בפעם אחת כל מה שבלעה מהקדושה. But the major rule is that the klipa cannot throw out or give out or vomit out everything that it holds from the kedusha. It has to come in increments. It has to come in installments, so to say. Now I did a sin. My kedusha, my nitzotzot, my sparks fell into the klipa. It can come out in one shot. It has to come out in small portions. Umeshum hachi, and because of that, hutzrechu lavo mehem shnei lumim. Because of that, two nations had to come out. Dahainu, meaning shnei umot, Edom v'Israel. Two nations, Edom and Israel. Why? כי ברבות האומה של עשיו יצאו ממנה כתיע בר שלום, קוסטנירו, רבי חנינה בן תרדיון, שמיה ואבטליון, רבי מאיר. Because from the nation of Edom, from the generations of עשיו, you know how many great sages came? I just named their names. Great sages that they came from Gerim, they converted. Or either they converted, שמיה ואבטליון, they converted. Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Akiva, I mean, they all came from Gerim, from non-Jews. Where did they come from? From the nation of Esav, from Edom. They didn't come from Ishmael, they came from Edom. Therefore, two nations had to split. Okay? How many converts came out of the klipa that came from Esav? So when our sages explain they're going to split out of your womb or whatever, no, it says me'ayim, Nitraba koach kedusha, the power of kedusha of holiness became stronger. Why? Lehotzi et shela mitachat yad haklipa, to be able to pull out what belongs to the kedusha underneath what is captured in the klipa. Kmo shekatvu amekubalim, as our sages, but specifically the teachers of Kabbalah have explained that because of that, the splitting. That's what gave us the power to be able to take back from the klipa what belongs to us. Now, the verse continues. So we're kind of putting everything in order. But the verse continues but saying, Uleom meleom yamatz. Oh, wait a minute. Now you're kind of taking me to a completely different place. This is a very important verse to remember. The translation is, one kingdom will become mightier than the other kingdom. This is the ultimate fight between Esav and Israel. But a second ago, you just explained that it was on purpose that the two should split. Why? To give holiness the power to take back what belongs to it from the klipa. But now you're putting me another obstacle. Oh, one will be greater than the other? So how am I going to take out the kedusha? She'af ha'umah shel Esav mo'elet harbe le'Yaakov, even though The reason for that is because the nation of Esav is only good for Yaakov. Really? How can it be good for Yaakov? You know who came out from Esav? What problems we have up until today coming from Esav? All the problem, all the troublemakers to our nations came out from Esav. I mean, our major enemy is Amalek. I mean, we're going to now celebrate Hanukkah, but right after that comes Purim. Who was the major enemy in Purim? Haman. Haman was the Zera Amalek. Amalek is the grandson of Esav. And I told you already, I gave you a whole lecture explaining how the offspring, the seed of Esav, how they went from one place to another and how they ended up in Germany, in Germania. So the Germans also, the Aryan race, it's all coming off from Esav. So why are you telling me now that the nation of Esav is good for Israel? You know why? Because Shehu Marbe Torah b'Israel. Because of Esav, we're increasing Torah in the nation of Israel. What? Because of Esav, we learn more Torah. Okay, so the Midrash, specifically Midrash Rabbah says, Hakol Kol Yaakov. The voice is the voice of Yaakov. That's what we're going to learn, right? In this parasha. When Yaakov comes in to the tent, Yitzchak is blind. And he says, wait a minute, the voice is Yaakov, but the hands are Esav. The Midrash says, Shekolo shel Yaakov nishma bevate knesiot. When the voice of Yaakov is being heard in a shul, in a synagogue, ubate midrashot, in a yeshiva, en hayadayim yedei Esav sholtot. The hands of Esav cannot have any control. Ah. This is just prophecies. Telling us, oh, you have a problem with Esav? Then you have to increase in Torah. Haman wanted to destroy us. What do you think? The Mordechai gathered an elite commando unit to fight them? They had a whole year to prepare. It wasn't like from here till tomorrow. Mordechai gathered all the kids, put them in one room, started learning Torah. That's our power, not with our hands and spears or swords. The power is in the Torah. That's why you see now in our generation, who are they going after first? The kids who are learning in yeshivot, let's somehow eliminate them. Because then we don't have kids learning in yeshivot. Where is our power? The power is the Kakol Kol Yaakov. The voice is the voice of Yaakov. The voice of Yaakov is being heard in the world by learning Torah. Then the hands of Esav have zero power. And I know a few people are going to start arguing, yeah, but what happened and this and then and that. Okay? First of all, it's also giving prophecies to the end of days. Because the other day I gave a class, somebody wrote, yeah, but all in the Holocaust there were maybe many righteous people, and see what happened. I'm not talking about the Holocaust right now. And maybe, I'm nobody to judge, but maybe the voice of Yaakov was not heard enough, that the hands of Esav had an upper hand. And when you let go from Torah, as sholet Esav, then Esav has the power. Vezeu amalei hacherba. That's why our sages explain. This can be found also in the tractate Megillah, page 6. It explains in the depth, but it says uleom eloom yamatz shemipachad shel Esav Israel itamtzu b'Torah. Why is that a good thing? Why more Torah is because of Esav? Because of the fear of Esav, we're going to learn more Torah. If there wouldn't be any threats, we would be sleeping, right? Now there's threats, everybody's learning Torah, reading Tehillim. So because of Esav, we're increasing in Torah. V'im tomar shel olam o yechach v'yeh la reshut l'klipa lishlot. But what are you going to say if you're giving control to the klipa? Right now, for example, pretty obvious that the klipa is controlling the world. It's pretty obvious. You don't have to be a genius to see that. U'ma ho'alnu betakanato shetisbol Rivka. So what did we benefit from that? That Rivka now had to go through sorrow. So Esav can come out, and then because of the fear of Esav will increase in Torah, but the klipa is in control. Kol kach tzar gadol kede lotzia kedusha mimena. Such a sorrow only to pull out the kedusha out of the klipa. And don't forget that started already in the sin of Chava. There was a lot of kedusha, a lot of sparks of holiness in the klipa. Look how much sorrow just to pull these sparks out. Mishum hachi, that's why he added, Ve'rav yavod tzair. You have to read the whole verse. If you're not, if you don't come prepared to the class with reading the verse, it's a little bit harder. I mean, we're going through one portion after a portion in the verses. What does it mean, Urav? Sorry, first it says, Uleom leom liamatz. One kingdom will overcome the other kingdom. And then it continues, Ve'rav yavod tzair. The elder will serve the younger. Ah, so now you're calming the situation down. The elder, right, is going to be in control. The younger will serve the... Sorry, it says, Rav Yavod Tzair. Sorry, in the beginning it says that the older will serve the younger. Now, it puts us in a little bit of a question, because if we're looking at that Esav came first, good that the older serves the younger. But in Esav sold the firstborn, so now it's flipped. That Yaakov is the older and Esav is the younger, so we're serving the Klipa. Unfortunately, we are. It shouldn't have said that one kingdom will overpower the other. The mashma shuuma achat mitgaberet, when one kingdom is overpowering, mishel chaverta, on the over the other kingdom, kshiyisrael lo yizku, when we don't have the merit, veyigremu lenitzotzot hakdusha sheyitpazru betoch haklipot, when we cause the sparks of holiness to go into the klipa, as a klipa mitgaberet, then the klipa will have the upper hand, v'sholetet aleihem, then the klipa controls us. Saying in other words, that right now the situation is pretty obvious that the klipa is controlling us, which means that our Torah is not strong enough. V'lehefech, but on the other side, the other option, k'shehem zochim, when we have the merit, meaning when we're increasing in Torah, zochim v'torfim anitzotzot. We have the merit and we like a litrof, means like a lion that he comes and charges. Torfim t'anitzotzot, we grab the nitzotzot. Me'aklipa, from the klipa. As it says in the book of Eyov, chapter 20, verse 15, chayil balav yakienu. He swallowed up wealth and vomit. The klipa swallows up the wealth, but then it vomits. You know, three times a day when we pray Shmona Esre, we have to, there's a certain portion in Shmona Esre that we have to focus on, meditate on how we're removing the klipa, the nitzotzot dusha out of the klipa. And one has to meditate on the letters Chet Bet Vav, Chayil Baya Vayakienu, Mi Bitno Yorishenu Kel. But when we do that, Az Mitgaberet Yad Israel Al Ha'umot, when we have the upper hand by learning Torah, then we're in control. Now, when it says, "Umau shechazar lomad v'rav yavod tzair," but we're still left with a verse that says that the older one will serve the younger one. So that doesn't look so good for us right now, because originally it's good that the older one serves the younger one. Esav will serve Yaakov. But it was switched. Yaakov bought the firstborn. So why is he saying that? Mikol sheken shu hefech uleom meleom, it's the complete opposite. The mashma shem shem shavim. What do we learn from that? That they're both equal. Ela vaday sheba leodienu. But of course, it comes to tell us a message. Shedavar ze sheleom uleom yamatz. That when we're looking at that one kingdom will overpower the other. Lo itkayem. It's not going to be fulfilled. Ela ad hazman sherav yavod tzair. Only when the older one will serve the younger. Miklal, what's the rule that we can take out of that? She'atid lavo zman, that in the future will come a time shelo yeh rav v'tzair ba'olam, that there wouldn't be the older or the younger. Haino, meaning k'shebala ha'mavet lamnetzach, when the klipa will disappear from the world. Right now the situation is that if we are increasing in learning Torah, and we have the upper hand, then uleom uleom yamatz, the one kingdom overpowers the other, so it flips that Esav is the firstborn, right? Because he serves the younger. Then we lose our upper hand when we let go from the Torah, and the one kingdom overpowers the other, then the Bechora switches again. Now we are serving Yaakov. But when it says, that's what it says, both are equal, shavim, because it switches, depending on us. It's almost like with the war, with Amalek, everybody went out to war, Moshe and Aaron and Elazar, they were sitting there. It says when Moshe would raise his hands, then the nation of Israel, the army of Yeshua, overpowered. He put the hands down, they lost. Same thing here. But in the future, the prophet Yeshayahu in chapter 25, verse 8, it says, when death or impurity, the klipa will disappear for eternity, then you know what's the result? There is no older or younger, because there's no older anymore. She'az kol ha'kdusha tiyeh nifredet min ha'klipa. Then all the kedusha will be separated from impurity and klipa. She'en ken le'et ata, but right now, ha'uma shel Israel, the nation of Israel, shehi harav, she's the older brother, because Yaakov bought the Bechorah. Yesh la harbe kedusha, we have so much kedusha, but it's all in the klipa. Shem yirachem. Ta'avod ha'klipa, shenikret tzair. Then it's serving the klipa that it's called the younger one. Because Yaakov bought the Bechorah. We are the Bechor. We are the Kedusha. But it's all by the Ketumah. We are serving the klipa. I don't know if I need to explain too much about that. But most people are hypnotized by the klipa. And they're working for the klipa. Very few people are not working for the klipa. For the impurity. Impurity has us wrapped around its little finger. Umishum me'ata nitzotzot shebetocha, because we're holding now less nitzotzot, all the godly sparks is held by the klipa. Shechelek zeh me'at, we're holding just a little bit. But nevertheless, this is about to be over very soon, when Mashiach is going to come. So just to conclude, the Kadosh Baruch comes to Rivka and he tells her, Ma sheyeh ad sof ha'olam. This whole message from the Kadosh Baruch to Rivka is not then, it's for the end. Here he says sof ha'olam, the end of the world. I don't have to take it literally, or maybe what are we getting? What message are we getting? The end of the world. But nevertheless, saying clearly that the message that Hashem gave to Rivka through Shem, it was for the end of days. Hoil shehitchil ha'tikun me'ibur shela. The tikun started from her pregnancy. Umishum hachin, therefore, he'erich b'tshuvato b'chol ele advarim. So therefore, the prophet gave her a lot of details. You have two nations in your stomach. One is going to overpower the other. Then later on, the older one will serve the younger one. Ooh, he gave a lot of details, more than an ultrasound. And what's the pshat? Lefi apshat hem dvarim yetirim. According to the simple explanation, it's just for that time. It's irrelevant for later, because later on, there's not going to be much more left anything in the klipa, and the klipa will cease to exist. So we get here a beautiful answer to all these questions that we presented in the beginning. But as our regular custom, what good is the Torah that we learn if we don't apply something practically? I mean, we got a beautiful explanation. You want a good drash of what's going on for in one little verse. Zera Shimshon laid it out in a very clear and powerful way. But now, how is that applying to me, especially when it's talking about the end? So the message is very simple. I mean, I can now explain to you now 2 hours of what he's saying here. What I'm getting from here. But the simple explanation right now is that right now there's a war between good and evil. Good is kedusha, holiness, and evil is tum'ah, the impurity, that of course is rooted by Esav. Esav, okay, so Esav did tshuva. It doesn't mean his kids did tshuva. We know that Esav at the end did tshuva. But his kids, look what came out from Esav. Besides, first of all, he had a lot of kids. But specifically from a kid called Elipaz, came out of, from that Amalek, all the tum'ah and all the evil in the world are all coming from there. Okay, so we can argue and say, of course, a lot of evil is coming from Ishmael. But the main evil that right now runs the world are all descendants of Esav, and same thing also of Amalek. They're controlling right now the show, and there's a fight between good and evil. Yesterday somebody came, what can we do? You can't do nothing. Sit and learn Torah, that's all you can do. Doesn't matter who you're going to vote for. Doesn't matter how much weapons you're going to buy. It doesn't matter. You can't do anything. The only thing you can do is sit and learn Torah. Simple as that. Why? Because exactly what we explained here. When we are letting go from the Torah, Hakol Kol Yaakov, if we're letting go from the Torah, then the hand of Esav has control. But when we don't let go from the Torah, Hakol Kol Yaakov, when the sound of Yaakov is being heard, Yadei Esav, the hands of Esav, have zero power. That's our power. You want to change the outcome of what's going to happen now? It's only if we sit and learn Torah. And it's not just learning the Torah. We also have to apply the Torah, fulfilling the mitzvot. What the Torah teaches me to do, then you have to apply it. Each and every one of us has the obligation to do so. Other than that, we're going to see the control of Esav going out of control. And trust me, this is not going to be a nice sight. And like I told you yesterday, don't think it's going to come in a way that is very obvious. People think, oh, if there should be a war at the end of days, okay, I'm expecting maybe bombs and missiles and destruction. Who says it's going to come like that? I told you yesterday that what was the speciality of Esav? He was a liar. He was a cheat, a con artist. Tzayid mepiv. Tzayid means a hunter, but with his mouth. He wasn't walking around with dirt and a spear. He had a suit. And I told you already yesterday, maybe he worked for the WHO, maybe to the CFR. I don't know who he worked for. But he came with a suit, and he says, no, it's all humanitarian. It's for the greater good. And he was able to fool everybody, exactly like Nimrod. Why do you think he killed Nimrod? Nimrod was the first Freemason that came and turned the entire world against the master of the universe. And everybody believed him. Which is, you know, maybe a year or two ago I would say, how did they all believe Nimrod? Now when I see 7 billion people believing the sheker, the lie, the deception that was going on now I understand how Nimrod was able to fool an entire generation. The same way that the entire generation now is being fooled. I mean, there's a fraction, maybe 1 or 2%, that they see the truth and they can't fathom. How do you believe this? You really believe that? Shlomo Melech says, "En chadash tachat haShemesh." Nothing is new under the sun. Ma shehaya, hu shiyeh. What was is what's going to be the same. So don't think that Esav is coming with a chain of bullets here and a machine gun. That may be the ISIS, Daesh, they do. It's just a bunch of hooligans. Esav comes with a suit. He has a lot of, degrees from university. Very educated. And he lies with his mouth and he's able to fool everybody. That's why Esav took out Nimrod. Nimrod didn't work well with Esav. He didn't want that he's going to have the control. So Esav says, listen, I don't like you. And he took him out. So he can have the control. That he can be the next world leader and to control the nation through lies. No violence. We're not being violent here. So we have an Esav in our generation. Some people are seeing the truth and they're a little bit worried and scared. The majority are blind with their heads stuck in the ground, so they don't care. But the ones who are a little bit aware, they're saying, well, how are you going to fight this right now? How are you going to fight what's coming to us? Can you really fight that? Yeah. Sit down on your tuchus and start learning Torah all day long, whatever you can. And then take the Torah that you learn and then apply that. If you don't apply what you learn, then you're missing the point. That's our power. You want to do something good in the universe? You want to overpower the klipa? I mean, there's very, very, very obvious things, but you know what? In 3.5 weeks, we're going to commemorate and celebrate one of the biggest miracles that happened in our history. A nation came to annihilate us. A few old gazers came out of the Beit HaMikdash. All they knew, they were priests. They weren't like guerrilla fighters or MMA fighters. They were old men. And a few of them. And they go and they fight an army in the size, just so we have the idea, like 10 men going to fight now the army of Russia. And China and Iran together. And they win. That's the miracle, by the way. The fact that they found a pitcher in 8 days, that's a nice miracle. But the miracle of Chanukah is the victory of the war. The holiday is called over the victory. Chanukah is Chanu. They stopped when? In Cafe, in the 25th day of Kislev. That's when the war stopped. Later on came another miracle. as we say in Hebrew, ala derech, yala, two for the price of one. So I'll give you the picture. But really the miracle was the victory of the war. Our power is a kol Yaakov. That you take your Torah seriously. You learn Torah, whatever you can handle, then double that. When you pray, you put your mind to it. You apply what you learn. To learn Torah 4 or 5 hours a day and to pray 3 times a day and all this, and then you go and gossip and slander and lie. What's your Torah? What did you do? So what if you show up 3 times a day to pray? Then you go and gossip and slander and destroy people's lives? Your Torah is worthless. Go home. Apply what you learn. Talk the talk. Don't just walk the walk. Or no, it's the other way around, right? Walk the walk. Don't talk the talk. But no, I said talk the talk because I call Kol Yaakov, talk! But now it's also walk the walk too. So I don't know. I read this today. I was like, whew. What revelations. Rivka already got the prophecy. At the end of days, if you're not going to move your lips to learn Torah, Esav is going to have the upper hand. And don't think he's going to come with violence. He's going to come with a nice smiling face. So we have a war to win. The war of evil. Don't think you can win it with violence. Don't even go into violence. Violence is not going to do anything. Riots, demonstrations, waste of time. Our power is only in our mouth, only in our mitzvot, only in our Torah. And that includes also the nations. A lot of non-Jews will say, but I'm not a Jew. So what? You still have to obey the 7 laws of Noach. You can still do mitzvot, commandments. You can still do acts of kindness and charity and help and whatever. What is one going to do with the other? We have to unite right now. What did he say at the end? I'm just going to read it again. V'adai sheba lo'odienu davar ze, sheleom lo'om ramatz, itkayem ela ad hazman sherov yavod tzair. Sorry. Miklal she'atid lavo zman achar shelo yerav v'tzair. Because in the future there will be a time that there's not going to be the older and the younger. You know, at the end of days, which is going to be the beginning of the good days, there's going to be one nation. One nation under God. So right now we all have to unite and we all have to do our part. But that's the only way to fight the evil regime. That's the only way to have a miracle coming into our direction. And the message is pretty clear. Hakol Kol Yaakov. It's all how much we're holding to the Torah. And most people, by the way, like I said before, they're hypnotized by the klipah. The klipah has them wrapped around the finger. Even the most religious people. With slandering and gossiping and the anything that has to do with promiscuity and lewdness. And these are, I'm talking about right now, the religious people, not other people. The klipah has control over. You can't have the klipah overpower you. And if you feel that you're stuck inside the depth of the klipah, the only way is with Torah. Increase with Torah. It doesn't work, add another half an hour, another hour. Learn right. Do it the right way. But we have a promise that at the end, Chayil Balav Ayakienu, all the Kedusha is going to come back. Right? Ve'itzu b'rchush gadol. We have a great wealth. I'm not talking about millions. We don't need millions. We need the Nitzotzot Kedusha, the sparks of Kedusha. We go with a great wealth. And more than that, Amaveti Balal Netzach, the klipah is going to cease to exist. But there's not going to have to be a fight. There's going to have to be a war between good and evil. And it all starts here. So we have tools, solutions. Now it's time for actions.